Welcome to Bourbon and Bud, everybody. We got a special episode tonight. Going to be a relatively quick one. We got a guest coming on. His name is Reese Baby Goose Watkins. He is an up-and-coming prospect. Trains out of Team Lima, I'm pretty sure, full-time in Atlanta. He's 2-0 as a pro. I think he's 4-1 as a amateur, maybe? Something like that. Yeah, he's a damn good fighter. He's an up and coming. He's got hands of diamond. I mean, the dude's a fucking stud.
Violent. He's violent as fuck.
He's violent. We're excited to have him on.
I was saying Trains part time out of Extreme Clips number 2, so that's pretty cool. But
gonna get him an invite here to the show here soon. We're gonna take a shot before we kick it off.
All right. I'm gonna go ahead and send him the link. That away we're good to go.
Hell yeah. Cheers, boys.
All right. Cheers.
Every day I spend my time drinking wine, feeling fine, waiting here to find the sign that I can understand. Yes, I am. So every day I spend my time drinking wine, feeling fine, waiting here to find the sign that I should take it slow.
Yo, what's up, man? Hey, what's up, man?
What's going on, bro? Appreciate you hopping on with us.
Hey,
All right. So, everybody, this is Reese Watkins, Baby Goose, MMA fighter, 2-0 professionally.
Baby.
Yes, sir.
Anyway, so, yeah, we're happy to have you on, man. Appreciate you coming on. Kind of want to give you some shine, you know, and ask you a few questions, obviously. So, anyway, I guess I'll start off. So, are you still fighting on Friday? Is that confirmed?
No, it's off.
It's off. Okay. Okay.
They kind of find it. Is what it is.
Do you get a lot of canceled fights?
No, this is my third one, I think. But this is the first one I've had, like, so close to a fight. My pro debut, the original date got scrapped, but I was still like 4 or 5 weeks out from it. But this one, yeah, this one was rough.
Right.
Yeah. Well, how long ago did you find out? Since the fight, right?
Last Wednesday.
And were you cutting weight already?
Kind of. I mean, I was at like 203 that morning. And then I changed like my lifestyle around. So I eat clean year round now, pretty much. So, you know, outside of camp, I'll walk at like 207, then like peak camp, I'm getting in like 203. So,
nice.
You know, it was kind of rough. Yeah.
Did you get to enjoy some Thanksgiving at least though?
Yeah.
I was gonna say the first time in years.
So,
right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you are full-time out of Team Lima, right? And part-time out of Extreme Couture?
Basically, yeah. So, yeah, Team Lima is my home, and then I've started doing part of my camp at Extreme. So everyone's been super, super welcoming. Coach Eric, Sean, Chris, they've all been really just super cool, super nice. Yeah, so I started going out there because one of my teammates, Carl Williams, he goes out there.
Mm-hmm.
So I just kind of linked with him, and then it just fell into place. Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, all right, man. So I mean, what's it like training out there? It's got to be. They're probably pretty tough guy, pretty tough, I'd say, right?
Yeah. It's different, but it's fun. It's really fun. I feel like I learned a lot very quickly. Picking up a lot of like little things. So I feel like the gap overall is like super small, but you know, guys who are that good, they don't make any like simple small mistakes. Mm-hmm. So getting to see that and getting to learn from them is great.
Is sparring Sean Strickland as brutal as they say it is?
kind of, you know. His style, he's really good at making people uncomfortable. And I feel like we have somewhat similar styles where we both like to go forward a lot. So it's definitely definitely an experience, but it's really fun. But it's an experience. So yeah, it can get kind of crazy a little bit.
I stopped by Extreme Couture. I think it was like 3 weeks ago, like just to drop in. It was amazing. I saw Sean. I didn't see you, man. It's not a fuck, you know? I'm chopping it up, but I saw a lot of people. It's a dope ass gym. It was so welcoming, you know? Like
Right. They're so nice.
from
So
the
nice.
front desk to like everybody, like all the coaches. It was cool. It was a dope experience.
They're great people.
I feel like that. I feel like that gym especially is particularly good with pressure fighters like you. I mean, like, because Sean's a pressure fighter, Chris is a pressure fighter, Francis, really, if you think about it, is a pressure fighter in a way. So, you know, I mean, I mean, do you think that's a big part of why like it works so well because of your style? That gym is perfect for your style.
I feel like it. They get it, especially like Sean and Chris. They they've been in like some crazy fights and some wars, so that style, they're very good at pointing out like little pointers and stuff that I need to fix. And I just kind of fit in well, because like our styles are very similar. And like size wise too, they have a lot of good 85ers and 170ers, like Tavares and Puna and John Poppy and all these other Alex Polizzi, or he's 205. But a lot of people like similar size, like Edmund Shahbazyan. So I feel like that's why, because a lot of pressure fighters. So
Perfect for that weight class too, yeah, for those, for that region, yeah.
yeah, I
What
think
got you into MMA? Oh, my bad.
sorry. Yeah, no, you're good. I think too, man, like that Team Lima gym is, I would say it's one of the more underrated gyms. And I know it's not the Extreme Couture, but it's more one of the more underrated places, I would say. We've had Trayshawn Gore on the podcast. He's a good one. I'm pretty sure Cody Durden's out there too, right? Or
Yeah, Cody is.
yeah. Yeah, I
Cody
mean it's
is
a
between here and then Coconut Creek.
Oh, cool. Yeah. So I guess what are like some of the like major differences and the good, like unique things about both, I guess, Team Lima and Extreme Couture? Like what have you noticed that's different, that's good? What's the same? Like which place, you know, like what are the pros of each place?
The pros of Lima, I'd say like it can be like a little bit smaller sometimes. With Diego, and then Coach Brantley Fur, they can like they'll see all of your reps, So it's the way I like to use it and view it is Lima is like it's kind of where you can put like your finishing touches on everything. And especially, Douglas and Diego. Diego's a really good well, Douglas and Diego, they're both really good Thai fighters. And they have like a really good Thai background. So one thing with especially sparring like Douglas or Diego, they have really good counter work. So, they make you super careful and super wary of leg kicks. So I feel like that's one thing a lot of people out of Lima are very good at, like high level people that come out of our gym, is checking leg kicks. Obviously, like if you've seen Trey fight, he sends them, he whips them in really fast, but it's really hard to land clean like leg kicks and calf kicks on people here because everyone is pretty good at them. And then with Extreme, I'd say their wrestling is actually like super solid. They wrestle a lot, like a lot. They have a lot of good wrestling guys out here, so I'll say that was the pros of each.
Right.
The kickboxing that comes out of Lima is solid. It's really
Oh,
good.
so I could totally see it. I mean, because you look at the leg kick that Diego Lima did to set up his knockout of MVP, and then you look at Extreme Couture. I mean, it's named after Randy Couture, you know. So it's wrestling.
It's
Have
hard.
you have you? Go ahead,
Go ahead,
man.
sorry.
Sorry. Oh, I was gonna say, have you gotten to meet Randy or anything yet, or does he
No,
come
I
out there
haven't.
very often?
I've seen him a couple times, but I haven't met him.
Right on.
Yeah, I mean that's like kind of going to that. Like they say, Sean Strickland, he never shows it, but they say his like ground game is like up there, like elite. So I mean, I feel like the wrestling at Extreme Couture definitely, I feel like, goes under the radar, but.
I feel like it is slept on. Or like another thing that goes to like the pros of each, There's a boxing coach out of Lima. His name is Coach Felipe. He used to coach like the Cuban boxing schools over there. So he's a has a lot of experience with Cuban boxers and such. Or like if you watch that first fight when Mike Perry was out of the UFC versus Mike Seals, that boxing fight, he coaches Mike. And one thing he's really good at having all his guys do, I don't know how to explain it, but their hands are very heavy. So kind of sounds stupid, but it feels like they hit you harder than they should. So even if they don't, even if they're not putting all, even if they're not sitting down all the way into a punch, it's still a super heavy punch. And it's something with how they hold their fists kind of. They kind of turn their fists down a little bit. So it looks counterintuitive, but their fists will kind of be like this a bit, kind of bent. So when they hit someone, you know, they never land with just like the top of their hand or the front of their fingers. It's always, they're always driving all their knuckles into you. It adds up. You feel it because you're like, this guy's throwing that hard, but I feel the knuckles each time it hits. So that adds up. So both Diego and Douglas are super, super good at that.
Oh, yeah. So, I mean, enough about the gyms. Let me ask about you. What got you into MMA, man? What?
I started doing jiu-jitsu when I was 14, and at the time I was training with Bruno Frazado. Nah, he's friends with Davi Ramos and Wilson Hayes. Hayes, that's how you say it. They were both up here. I think Davi was getting ready for. He's getting ready for some fight. I forgot who he was fighting. But Bruno just asked me, he's like, have you thought about doing MMA? He's like, I think you'd be good at it. And yeah, I just kind of just started taking Thai classes from there and kind of just went downhill. Or not downhill, but kind of spiraled there.
Right.
Yeah.
Hell yeah, man. So, I mean, what's your favorite aspect? Or what's your favorite martial art that you train? What would you say?
Definitely Thai.
Muay Thai.
Fu's our resident Muay Thai guy. He used to fight professionally Muay Thai.
I love that shit. That shit about the knuckles is crazy, bro. What you were saying about that, because like it's bone on bone, you know. That shit adds up.
It does. It adds up quick. Like you don't realize it, but it amounts. Like over a course of a round, you feel it, you know.
It's like, damn, I was looking, he started in jiu-jitsu. I was like, that shit don't look like he likes jiu-jitsu. This fucker's not going out there. He found out he had dynamite in his hands.
It's kind of fell in love with striking, you know, so here we
are. That's a good question, too. What do you think so far? I mean, I know you're 2-0 as a pro. I think you're, 5-1?
Was your amateur record? Yeah, 5-1. MMA and then 4-1 in amateur Muay Thai.
Okay. What do you think so far? Like which one was your favorite, you think? Which fight?
Either this last fight I had against Navarro. I wanted an elbow knockout for so long.
That was insane. That's the one on your pinned tweet, right? On your Twitter.
Yeah. That one. Cause I felt really good for that. Or I think my last amateur fight I had with Jacob Hall, that was a really fun fight.
That one I watched in full on lunch today, and I'm not gonna lie, I loved it. I loved it.
You're crazy.
That was a good one. Yeah. I liked how so in the first round I saw he landed that uppercut. It was a pretty nice uppercut, but like, were you actually hurt? Because it didn't look like it.
The uppercut he dropped me with.
Yeah, in the first round.
I was hurt. I was like, I remember thinking, okay, like round's almost over. And I was pretty sure I was winning the round.
Yeah.
You know, I got clipped. And I remember thinking when I got clipped, I'm like, yo, why am I on my ass? And why is everything sideways? Mm. And everything was kind of happening like in slow motion. And I was like, oh shit. Am I supposed to curse? My bad.
But no,
I was like,
you're good. Do it now. You're all good.
I was like, oh shit. I got dropped. And I was like, okay, damn, I gotta get back to my feet. Thankfully, it was at the end of the round. So I think I would have recovered fine. I think I was like starting to recover, double leg, but either way, ended up getting kind of, I guess, technically saved by the bell, kind of. And then I remember going back to my corner. And I think I recovered pretty fast because like I'm like dad, get dropped. And they're like, yeah. I'm like, dad, lose that round. Like, yeah, probably. And I was like, fuck. I'm in the corner, and I was like, okay, I got to go back and get it back. Go back out and get it. So
you fucking did. That's what I was thinking. That's what I was saying, because like I saw that happen and I was like, oh shit. And the like commentators were going crazy, so I had to just turn that shit down because they were blowing my headphones out of the but like it looked like you recovered so quick that I almost even wondered if you were hurt, because like it did look like you recovered super quick with that double leg, like you said. And then in the second round, one thing that I fucking loved, like you heard him and you knew you heard him, but and you like clearly like put the pedal to the floor, but like in a responsible, like technically sound way. Like you didn't just throw some stupid shots. Like you were throwing, like you were still throwing your jab, like that double jab you landed when he was hurt, like when he was clearly hurt. I was like, damn, that's fucking smart. A lot of people in MMA, it seems like they don't do that.
Thank God. I remember one of my fights, it was one of my MMA fights. I fought this guy named Gavino, and I hurt him with a head kick. I kind of gassed out, kind of trying to finish him. And then, I ended up getting the finish, but I remember I got tired at the end. So I just, like, going forward now, I'm like, okay, you can't, like, gas out, you know, because some people have just, you know, super strong chin. So you got to pick your shots and, like, walk them down responsibly, you know.
Yeah, that boy took a shot for sure. That stand TK was warranted for sure, but, I mean, damn.
Yeah.
You were fucking him up. I was like, that's what caught my eye. I was like, damn, that is so, like, the way you handled it was smart, because he was hurt clearly, but he wasn't going down, and you didn't fucking just you didn't empty the tank, you know what I'm saying? So like that's a great sign, especially with like a young fighter like that. That was fucking awesome to see.
Yeah, that comes from I mean, I haven't had like the most fights, but I think I'm at like 13 fights now. Which is like a pretty decent number. And you know, I just turned 22, so I feel like I have a good amount of cage time and like what's it called? Ringmanship and fight IQ. There we go. Fight IQ.
Oh, yeah.
There you go.
So I feel like I have a good number, or a good amount of it for how many fights I've had, you know, just getting reps and reps. So.
And you're only going to get better, bro, you know, like every day, like, with training, like that, you move camps too, you know, like it's a lot sacrifice, but you're doing it like to better yourself, you know?
Yeah, for sure.
But the sky's the limit, bro, you know, and you set your own fucking limit. So.
Yeah.
Grinding, bro.
it's cool to see too. I mean, you were MMA Mania's prospect of the month. Kaposa retweeted your knockout and talked about you. You know, I mean, it's super cool to see, you know, you coming up like you are. Because I mean, obviously, we followed each other on Twitter for almost a year now, at least, and kind of we were in a group chat together. So obviously, like we've talked and stuff. And it's just, I mean, it's super cool to see you coming up, man. And like, we're super hyped to see where you go to. So that fight, that guy, so the guy canceled, he dropped the fight or whatever. I saw some tweets mentioning, are you rescheduling that? Or are you guys trying to reschedule that? Or what's
that may be rescheduled. I'm not sure yet. Bring a combat card after this December one is not until March. So it may be rescheduled. It may not, but I'm trying to stay active. So I may fight February in Alabama.
Yeah, I saw that. You was it seemed like you didn't like that dude very much.
No, I mean, I like the person, but not as a fighter. I have very little the fighter kind of so
man.
I really want to get that fight. So I hope it can work out, get made.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, Birmingham's only like an hour and a half drive for me, so I'm like
I was gonna say we'd like to see you in person sometime, or watch you on the screen. I was gonna say, man. Yeah.
What promotion would that be?
Made Men promotion. I think it's a newer promotion. It's definitely a small promotion. That's like one of the things talking about. I was talking to my coach about it today, because the pay is not great. It's pretty, rough, but you know, I'm not fighting. I mean, I still have a job, and I'm not fighting for like money. I'm not like in the UFC, so I'm like, oh, I need this amount of money to fight, you know. So it's more about like exposure and the number on the record and all that stuff. So I think we're leaning towards making it happen, just because you know, I'm not guaranteed to fight in January or February. You know, things may not line up, and this fight is pretty much like I just have to sign it. So I think we're gonna take it just to get like the number, just to get the number on the record in case something happens.
If you get that fight in and get another highlight reel KO, man, that's the thing. Like every time, you know, all the fights that I've seen online of you, and like you're violent, dude. That's the thing. I think that's one thing that I feel like will lend you in the future is how violent you are. Like, and that, and promotions look for that. You know, a lot of promotions look for that. So, yeah. You know, I mean, do you hold yourself to like a higher standard when it comes to like violence? You know what I mean? Like trying to.
I definitely like not like hunt the finish, but I was talking to my friend about it yesterday. I'm like, sometimes people get caught up in trying to just look for a finish or that one big shot. But the way I like to fight is that I like to fight to where I want to make the other person not want to be there anymore. So instead of like, oh, I want to get the knockout or I want to get the submission, I want to like mentally break so I can be like,
that's.
Oh, I know it's kind of like dark, but I'm like, I want to like make you regret your like life decisions that led you to this moment. And then once you make someone not want to be there, and once you get them out of there, so they're thinking about, oh my God, you know, I have two more minutes left or one more round left. That's when the knockout comes, because they're more open about it, because their mind's off the fight. So yeah, that's how I like holding myself to that standard of making people very uncomfortable. Yeah.
And the mental part of the game.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. Fighting is so mental.
Yeah.
So, yeah, and I'm very comfortable, almost like too comfortable being hit. So, yeah, I like to like use that aspect of it. And I was talking to one of my coaches one time. I'm like, I like to think about it where I like to use my cardio as like a weapon. So I know that I can stay in a high-paced fight longer than they can, and I'm more willing to stay in a high-paced fight longer than they can. So that's how I like to fight, and it just results in, you know, violent fights.
Do you bait them, like knowing that you're gonna fucking put hands on them, kind of like just engage, like you know, just bait, you know, because your cardio is there, you know.
Yeah, sometimes like it take me a second to kind of wake up and kind of like be in the fight. But yeah, I like kind of like walking people down and getting in their face to not give them room to think and not give them room to set up things and just not give them room to like breathe, you know, not let them relax in the fight. So
yeah, that's another thing. Watch. I mean, obviously, you know, I only watched the one full fight just because that's the only one that was available on YouTube at the time. But like noticing what you just said, like cardio. Even when you were getting hit by him in the first round, like, your facial expression never changed. Like, and especially when the second round started, like, he was breathing hard, and you were just same, like, stoic face expression, like, just ready to go. And that was cool. And it's not very common, at least in my opinion, to see a guy that can weaponize his cardio but also have, like, the power in his hands that you have. Because, like, you see people like Colby Covington who weaponize their cardio – but, like, you're not going to see Colby go out there and get, like, a highlight reel knockout, you know, that kind of thing. Bilal Muhammad, that kind of thing.
Yeah, I think that comes from, like, Muay Thai. If you watch a lot of, like, Thai fighters and stuff, they like, outside the first round, because, you know, they all take the first round off. But once, like, second, third round hits, they sit down and all their punches, you know. So their combos, their 2-3 punch combos, whatever, they're all, like, hard shots. And especially if you get, like, hit in if you get hit, you walk forward because forward aggression, they score like forward pressure, forward aggression. So it's really hard to, or it's harder to win a tie fight going backwards. So
yeah, you can't counter in a tie fight. I lost so many fights because I was a counter fighter, dude. It's like I learned the hard way.
You can be like the more skilled fighter, but if you're going backwards, they don't like that. So like you can win a fight even if you're less skilled, because you're going forward. So that mentality of like, okay, even if you got hurt or even if that shot rocked you, keep going forward. Don't let them know that it hurt you. I feel like I got that from Muay Thai and brought it over to MMA. And I feel like it works. A lot of people aren't used to that. So, yeah.
Did you learn the white crew?
Man, I did. I don't know if, like, the full one anymore, but I used to know it. I used to know it. Yeah.
I suck, right? I think they used to take points off because I didn't do the white crew every time when I walked out.
Really?
Fuck yeah. But that shit's dope, bro. Like, when you see it, like...
Yeah.
When you're fighting and the music's going on.
Yeah.
My parents are Mexican. They were tripping out. They went to my first fight, like, what the fuck is this? You know? They used to, like, boxing and shit.
Yeah, I brought my dad to a fight. He's like, why is this taking so long? I'm like, nah, it's part of it. You just gotta wait. It's part of it. So
Did you ever think about going pro in tie fighting?
yeah, I did. Georgia just had a 4 ounce Muay Thai. It just got legalized. And I was like begging for so long when I was still an amateur for that to be legalized. I was even trying to get fights arranged with guys. I'm like, okay, look, let's just shake hands behind closed doors where neither of us are gonna take down. We're just gonna have a tie fight. We'll just have a it never happened, but yeah, I was thinking about it now, but I don't think I will anymore. Maybe later down the road, but not right now. Now with like the goal is close. So yeah, no, I'm
Right,
out.
yeah. I was gonna say
What
you're
is
getting there,
so
man.
I guess going from that, what you just said, I guess what is the timeline for you? What are you thinking like timeline wise as far as your career like trajectory?
I would like to be like hopefully on the next season or the season after that of Dana White's Contender Series, or I think the PFL is coming back like four times, I think, in Atlanta. I think I've heard allegedly.
I heard
So
that too.
yeah, so I would like to I want to get to like 4-0 or 5-0, hopefully definitely 4-0 before like May or June. And I know Contender Series fights. I know they start matching them in like March, in March. They book them early, even though they don't start until like June. So, like realistically, I probably won't make this next season of Contender Series.
I think you could, dude.
Maybe we'll see. But if someone gets hurt, I'd like to be able to like fill in. It's like late notice or short notice replacement. So I definitely have like to be like 4-5-0 like May, but I don't want to rush. Like, oh, I want to be UFC champion or whatever by a certain age. Gonna sound like really dumb, but UFC champions they're very good. Like they're champions for a reason.
Well, you trained with once, so
Yeah. Or like ranked fighters, they're ranked, for a reason. They're very, very fucking good. Like you see that a lot with younger contenders, especially in the UFC. They don't give people easy fights. Like what happened by like Chase Cooper or Darren Till, or just off the top of my head with like young prospects and stuff, they kind of like fed them and they weren't fully ready. So I don't want to put like a age or oh, I want to be in the UFC by this age or whatever. But I'll say I want a certain number of fights by a certain age. So hopefully by 23, I want like six or seven fights. Hopefully. So yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, I mean, if you start, if I can see it, man.
Yeah.
I
I'm
see it
trying to
happening.
think. I know like so the Contender Series, I'm pretty sure they start, I mean, I know like they do the Contender Series like what, September through October?
No, I thought it's January. I mean, June through like August, I think.
The Contender Series, I'm pretty sure it's because we had
Ryan Guerrero.
Rain
Yeah, we had Ryan.
Guerrero on, and
Yeah.
she was in the Contender Series. We had her on in June, but she didn't fight till September on the Contender Series. I'm pretty sure they
Yeah, they
start.
push it
I'm
back.
looking for a picture in my phone because I had the
Think it
because I
starts in
was
August, I thought.
following the
Okay,
matchmaking very
no.
closely.
Would you rather do the Ultimate Fighter or the Contender Series?
Probably the Contender Series.
Yeah.
Ultimate Fighter. It's I don't
Depends
know.
on the
I
coach,
feel like
right? If somebody was a special coach, who would be the only coach that'll make you want to be on the Ultimate Fighter? Like if they were your coach.
Oh gosh. Could you imagine Sean Strickland on the
one fighter I really want to work
Ultimate
with. Sean, yeah, Sean, because I really like working with him, and then Coach Eric super good, so I assume he'll bring him as one of the
Oh yeah.
coaches. Or Tito. I really want to work with Tito.
Yeah,
I like
hell
Tito's
yeah.
style.
That's what we
I feel like we
like.
have a very similar style. And Jason, I always hear great things about Jason Perillo. So
Oh,
I'm sure it would be
dope.
like a blast to work with him. So yeah, Sean or Tito. I feel like Tito especially because we have like very, very similar styles, I think.
Man,
So
Cheeto and Sean O'Malley
yeah.
as coaches, that'll be
Bro,
fucking.
dude,
That would be
they
cool.
should book
That
it.
would be
I don't know
cool.
why they didn't book it, man. They should.
You could, I think, I think, I think, legitimately, honestly, I think legitimately, you could make. I think that would be better than the Connor and Chandler season because, well, they didn't care about that season, but like, I feel like Cheeto and Sean would actually give a shit. So,
yeah, right, so you know, but here's kind of like a good. So they this for this last season of Contender Series, they started doing the matchmaking in late March, early April, I think, because they announced Rangarera. I hit her up first on May 10th. So that's when I first reached out to her, and she fought early September at some point.
Yeah.
We just talked to that.
You could get me it. And Carl, we were at the PI when they were cutting weight for that Apex card. What was that, last week or 2 weeks ago? We were talking to Peyton.
Peyton Talbot.
Yeah. He said he knew around like May. So that solid.
Yeah, you could do it, man. Right. I think we're super high on you, man. We don't want to rush you, but like we just it's fucking cool seeing people that we like, you know, in there. So,
he's got a plan too, you know. So it's like, fuck, I don't want to rush him.
But
like, you have to have a plan too. Like, you can't just go into the sport and be like, I want to be a champ. I want to be a fucking champ. I want to be a champ. I want to be on TV. Like, nah, bro. You gotta grind, and it's like, it's a little grind, you know, like just waking up and going to the fucking gym, just changing your meal plan, everything. Like, dude, you got to experience Thanksgiving this year, so the fact that you hadn't done that, like, it must have been fucking weird as shit.
I couldn't sleep the night before because I'm like, because I talked to my point of contact for Ring of Combat, and then I talked to my coaches and manager. I was like, I asked them all through. I'm like, dude, should I enjoy Thanksgiving? You know, should I have like food? And now, of course, like, yeah, man. He's like, he's like, fucking relax. He's like, the guy said you're probably not gonna be able to find anything. He's like, just fucking relax, dude. I like straight up could not relax. I was getting like worried about it. So yeah, it's a weird feeling for sure.
I'm glad you got to enjoy it though, man. I mean, because I know that I remember I saw your tweets leading up to it. You were like, that's just funny. You were like, man, not getting to enjoy Thanksgiving, shit. Yeah. But so, I mean, we obviously asked some basic questions and stuff. What's who's your favorite fighter? Who's your favorite fighter of all time?
All time, Mirko Krokop.
What? Who? Yes, sir. That's mine too. Yeah,
of all time, it's probably Mirko.
Let's fucking go.
Mirko, Joanna. I really like Joanna.
Yeah,
TIE Fighter. I really like Cheeto. Probably GSP. And it's like a weird one, but I really like Kid Yamamoto.
That's a throwback.
Yeah, it is a big throwback. But
Iron Mike Zambides. Have you ever heard of him?
I have.
He knocked out a Kid Dynamite. I love those dudes, dude. That was great picks, man. Fuck.
I
was not expecting Krokop because I knew when he said Knuckles' favorite fighter. I was like, fuck, this was gonna get all fucking wet right now.
Did you see my face? I have Krokop tattoos, dude. I have a little tombstone. I have a couple of tombstones on my left ankle and a hospital sign on my right ankle.
That's a throwback. That's creative.
Right leg hospital, left leg cemetery.
That's creative though. Like the hospital. That's creative. That is a super creative tattoo. Hell yeah, man. So another basic question we always what is your go-to? This is mine because I'm a fat boy. I like asking these questions. What's your favorite go-to food after weigh-ins? Like, dots?
I love dots. Dots. we always go to. We're fighting like in the South. We go to Waffle House, but
hell yeah,
there's no Waffle House in fucking New Jersey, bro. It's fucking whack as shit. But
So wait, dots the candy or dots the ice cream?
Dots the candy, like the
candy. Yeah,
yeah, the boring.
I got
the old people shit. Yeah, I love dots.
I don't know why. Dude, dots. I got dots in the other room right now.
Is that the old people shit, bro? I felt that.
That's what everyone always says, bro. Every time I say it, I'm like, yeah, dots and like the opal candy. I'm like, what the fuck? I'm like, what the fuck?
No, dots are fire, bro.
That's what I'm saying. Dots are fire. They're good as hell. So,
hey, but
I introduced
these motherfuckers are also ancient, so they're some old
man. Yeah, we are old. We are old.
Hey,
we're the only ones here in our young 20s. Look at the fucking look at the gray and Foo's beard. Look at the gray and Foo's beard.
Why do you think I wear a hat? My fucking hair, my hairline ain't very good.
I'm 20 fucking four. I'm 24. My hairline's fucked. That's why I wear a hat. But
that's fair. But anyway, man, you guys got any more questions for him? I don't want to.
I don't know. Do you want to play any? How did you feel when you lost, bro?
I was very upset. I remember, like, I cried in the back. It's gonna stop. This is like really arrogant, but this is I haven't lost in like 3 years, so it's been a while. Not like a while, but I remember not feeling. I say that like, oh, I haven't lost ever. I just like straight up just do not remember like all the circumstances and everything that happened. I remember feeling very. I was very frustrated, because I lost a MMA fight and a Thai fight like back to back. So I was very frustrated, very disappointed. I felt like I let everyone down. I felt like that was the biggest feeling I had that I remember. I feel like I let everyone down. It wasn't great, but other than that, I don't remember exactly everything else. Because I was 18. Damn, so like almost 4 years ago. So it's been like a little minute. My memory.
You learned, right? You learned from that.
I felt like my loss at MMA was actually like super beneficial for my career because the way I lost against like a boring ass like John Fitch type wrestler, and I learned from that and I like how to fight them. It's benefited me tremendously. So looking back at it, I'm glad I lost that fight. Yeah,
but it was amateurs, not when you lost.
Yeah, it was amateur. It was my third MMA fight.
That's a good time to learn the lesson.
Yeah, for real. Yeah, you want to get him in at him. So
I've got a question. I've got a question regarding that about wins and losses and stuff. I mean, do you think it is like do or die? Like it's life or death when it comes to like losing a fight. And what I mean by that is some people, you know, they hold like Khabib's record up as 29-0 better than, you know, somebody like GSP who's lost 2 or 3, right? I mean, do you think that just because you're undefeated, it makes you like the best ever. Like, you know what I mean? Like, do you think that's super, or do you think losses are beneficial?
Yeah, I do. It's, you know, obviously it's better not to lose, but I think who you lose, I think losses outside of like major promotions when your job's not on the line are beneficial. Once you like, you start losing the UFC, depending, usually I say, you know, they're not beneficial. Depending, sometimes they are beneficial, you know, like with like Charles Oliveira or whatever, he learned like stuff like that, or who else had like a like Islam or whatever, he had that one loss and hasn't lost since, you know, so stuff like that.
Well, Sean lost back to back and now he's champion, so
Usman, or even like Nunes lost to Pena, and that like showed like she got like lazy and complacent and then came back and beat the shit out of her, you know. So I feel like sometimes it could be beneficial, but if you're like, you know, obviously you don't want to lose, but I feel like losing earlier in your career, it can be detrimental, like money-wise, you know, because obviously that's like half your paycheck gone and then it'll take longer to get to the UFC. But I feel like people are getting better at realizing that perfect records aren't everything, especially compared to like boxing. You know, boxing get a loss, it's like the end of the world. But MMA, you know, you're starting to see it's getting more competitive, but, you know, you're starting to see, oh, this person has 2 or 3 losses. No, it's not the end of the world, because I feel like, especially inside the UFC, people put up records so fast. So, like, one person I like to think of is, like, RDA. I think RDA has, off the top of my head, like, 13 losses. But if you look at who he lost to, it's like, well, shit, man. No, he never turns down a hard fight. You know, like, you look at his record, nothing but, like, top 10 fighters and champions. So, overall, I'd say it's not beneficial to lose. But there definitely are some special moments in life.
Yeah. I got to ask, too, how do you think Strickland versus DDP goes down? What are you thinking there?
You know, I'm biased because
right, of course.
Strickland, but I think he walks him down. I think DDP is not going to do well with someone who doesn't let him get away with bullshit. And Sean is very good at catching people when they don't expect it. So I feel like Sean's going to walk him down and maybe like I say third round finish. I feel like DDP is going to come out wild and swinging, you know, like he always does. And, he's not going to get someone who's going to sit back and, like, kind of pick his shots and counter like Whitaker. He's going to get someone who's always in his face.
Like Pereira, you know? Pereira knocked him out. Pereira's always – he's doing that tight shit.
So, I say, third round finish.
I think that also, like, DDP, he's unorthodox. He's kind of just fucking pro shit. Like, he just kind of throws stuff, and people aren't always ready for his just wild shit. But Sean's reads are, I mean, they're next level. Like, his ability to read a shot coming in is so fucking crazy. So, like, and that's the thing is, like, a lot of people don't realize, too, is Whitaker got caught by that straight jab. Jared Cannonier did the same thing. Pat did the left straight. And, you know, Sean doesn't play that shit. That's my thing. Is like anything that DDP throws, he's just gonna like read it ahead of time, and it's gonna piss DDP off, and he'll be able to like. I have really strong opinions on this fight, but yeah, I completely agree.
I mean, I don't know why people have forgotten already that Sean just went out there and made one of the best middleweights of all time.
You know what, Coach Eric, man, fuck, dude. Like, I was telling people for that fight, I was like, dude, you guys think, like, watch that game plan. You know, he might have a game plan for fucking Izzy, you know? Like, that's the only – that was the advantage. The only advantage he has is Coach E, you know? Like, that was crazy. Dude,
Coach Eric is the – he's Coach of the Year, hands down, and probably one of the best coaches in MMA. Him and Jason Perillo are – So – you mentioned to me in DMs, I'm not trying to like put you on blast and thing. Are you going back out there? Are you going to go back out and train with them for the end of camp?
Back out in December. December over Christmas and a little bit.
Oh, yeah. That'll be fun. Well,
Reese.
Yep.
Baby Goose, we appreciate you, man, coming on here. You guys got anything else to ask him before we get
on? I don't want to hold him back that much unless he's got a.
Right.
Yeah.
I'll say
his MMA knowledge is amazing. I like
dude, 22 years old and he knows this. I love it.
Like everybody else, you know, so it's good stuff. I'm excited, man. I'm excited for you. I'm excited for your future, bro. Yeah. Like your mentality is amazing. Like, fuck, dude. Like,
I'm excited.
But so thank you, Reese, for coming on, man. You got any plugs to put out there? Anything that you want to say before we get off here?
Sponsor Barber Orthopedics. You know, they're one of the best orthopedic facilities in the Southeast. And they're like, if you're an athlete or whatever, or just have an active lifestyle and you get hurt, just go to Barber and they'll get you right.
Barber Orthopedics?
Yes, sir. Barber Orthopedics. Yep.
Okay. Hell yeah, man. Reese, we help Max bring the dog off.
She's fucking forcing herself on.
Reese, we appreciate you coming on, man. Cheers from the Bourbon and Bud crew. We appreciate you, brother.
Thank you.
I have to get you back on here again sometime, man. We enjoyed this. It was cool. Also, I'm just still thinking about the fucking Mirko Krokop tattoo and the fact that he's your favorite fighter. So like that.
You could have not said that, Reese. Like, fuck, now I'm going to have to hear this shit for, like, a whole fucking year, bro.
That's who's got to live with it. But, yeah, man, we appreciate you, dude. Cheers, brother. Catch you some other time, man.
Thank you.
My pleasure, man. Good luck, bro.
Hopping on.
Yes, sir. Every day I spend my time drinking wine, feeling fine, waiting here to find the sign. That I can understand, yes I am. So every day I spend my time drinking.